Hey, good evening, everyone. I'm Bella Gerlach. I'm the Dean of Libraries. I want to thank you very much for coming out tonight. We love having these kind of events here in the library, and this is our first book signing with the Texas Tech Press, and we're very excited, and we look forward to many more. So before we get started, I want to recognize the staff who contributed their time and effort on the publication of the book and are coordinating this event. So that's Courtney Burkholder, Director of the University Press, John Brock, Marketing Manager for the University Press, the Library's Public Programming and Outreach Team, Mark Bryan and Chris Gregory are the people behind the curtain, and the members of the Library's Office of Communication and Marketing. So I'm now going to turn it over to Courtney so she can introduce Dr. Hutton.
Well, thank you all for coming tonight. As Dean Gerlach said, I'm Courtney Burkholder. I'm director of the Texas Tech University Press. I'm so pleased to be able to introduce our speaker tonight. And the press is proud to have him as one of our authors. I've been in publishing for over 20 years, and it's authors and books like these that are really a lot of fun to do and to work with. So, Dr. Tom Hutton is an internationally recognized clinical and research neurologist and educator. He's the past president of the Texas Neurological Society. He served as professor and vice chairman of the Department of Medical and Surgical Neurology at the Texas Tech School of Medicine. And he now lives on his cattle ranch near Fredericksburg, Texas, with his wife, Trudy. So I'm just very pleased to be able to introduce Dr. Tom Hutton. And he's going to be talking about his book, Carrying the Black Bag.
Well, good evening. Courtney, thank you for that lovely introduction. Dean Gerlach, I'm so appreciative of being here and leading off this series, I guess. So this is wonderful. It has been a pleasure working. I'll start right away working with Texas Tech Press. They are a group of professionals. Clearly, they made the book better. I could not thank you enough, Joanna, John, Courtney, all of your team, Amanda. They've all done such a fine job, and I do appreciate that. And I'm pleased to say that the book seems to be doing very well, and the reviews are coming out very positively. It's only been out now a couple of 3 months, I guess it is, John, is that right? But it seems to be doing well, and I just want to very publicly thank you for all of the hard work that you have done. What I'd like to do is talk about the book this evening, kind of intermix some comments and some readings from the book. One reviewer described the book as part memoir and part love story of a doctor for his patients. And I guess that's probably right, because I learned so much from my patients, and they were so special that I put a lot of that in the book, and they showed a great deal of courage and ability to cope, which I think is so good. Well, I've received a number of questions since I've been giving some of these book talks, and I'll try to address some of those right up front in case you had the same questions. But one of them is just, what is the book about? And I can do no better than perhaps read from the prologue to talk about what the book is. My stories are real and describe people afflicted by illnesses as told from my 40 years as a practicing physician. My accounts describe remarkable people who face life-threatening or life-altering illnesses such as Parkinson's disease, stroke, seizure disorders, Alzheimer's disease, Reye syndrome, and other serious and not-so-serious maladies. Many of these people responded in unique and inspiring ways that enlarge our consideration of the human condition. The medical anecdotes that follow also provide insights into faith, love, hope, and most of all, courage. Love has the utmost importance in the lives of ill people. Having witnessed easy deaths and deaths of those who struggle to the end, I remain convinced that those capable of expressing love had the easier deaths. I write of the importance of hope for patients and their caregivers. Hope supports the patient and family, empowers caregivers, and sometimes leads to unexpectedly merciful outcomes. Hope fuels the will to live and strengthens the efforts of caregivers to a degree that doctor-patient relationship also pivots around hope. Hope that sustains the patient and hope tempered by the doctor's scientific knowledge. Over my career, I found observing people with neurological disorders much like watching a person at a poker table pushing all his chips into the middle for a final all-in bet. Unfortunately, people with serious brain diseases usually lose, but sometimes and against seemingly insurmountable odds, they win. Lacking a miracle cure, however, I found most patients desired a means for preserving their dignity and reducing the hurtful impact on their loved ones. People have asked how long it took to write this book, and I'm somewhat embarrassed to say it took a good 5 years, and admittedly, I was working on other projects at the time, but perhaps even, hi, Emma. But it took me, it was 40 years in development, so that it really has been an effort that has taken quite a while, but one that, a book that just had to come. And I described it earlier this morning on your NPR station. It's like a West Texas driller who's drilling for oil. And it's like when you're going through your practice and you're busy and you're seeing these amazing things, but you can't do anything about it, or certainly not write about it. And they drill and they drill and drill. Finally, they hit that pocket of oil and gas and there's a gusher. And that's what it was like for me. I knew when I retired that what I wanted to do was write these stories. These people had oftentimes shared stories with me that and they had passed away, and I was the last person standing who could write these, and yet I thought it said something about not only them, but something about the human condition. Some people have asked me if I'd always wanted to be a doctor, and I really didn't. In fact, I was supposed to be the family lawyer, I think. And so what I might do is just read from the first chapter because it'll tell you how I got involved in medicine in the first place. In part, my choice of vocation should be credited to a beefy middle linebacker who played for the Richardson, Texas high school football team. Without his assist, I would likely become the attorney my parents had hoped. I never did send the brawny backer a thank you note because even after 50 years, the memory remains just too painful. I recall the story like this. In August of 1962, the Richardson High football team began two-a-day summer practices in the August heat. I was, at the time, a light-in-the-britches, 145-pound running back whose ambition certainly outweighed my talents. To identify patients with the most aggressive tendency, didn't I look terribly scary in that picture? There it is. Yeah. In order to identify players with the most aggressive tendencies, the coaches organized a one-on-one tackling drill that seemed to me akin to a human demolition derby. Okay, guys, how many of you did this head-on tackling drill? It's called the Oklahoma drill. Yep. Yeah, John, you did. Okay. Yeah, you remember this. Do you know this is now illegal in the state of Maryland to do the Oklahoma drill? This drill in football is responsible for more concussions than any other aspect of football. But we did it. What could we do? Two players hemmed in by blocking dummies faced off from 5 yards apart. On the coach's signal, the ball carrier plowed ahead while the other player attempted to tackle him. I recall with some particularly violent collisions, the coaches would whoop it up like wild banshees. Eventually, I worked my way to the front of the line. When I gazed across the line, my eyes must have enlarged to the size of truck tires. When I spotted the bruiser, before me hulked Butch, compressing the football in his hands as if it were a beach ball. He sneered before tucking the ball away in the crook of his elbow. The star senior middle linebacker, destined to become all-district, packed 230 pounds of muscle on his 5-foot-11-inch frame. He looked to me like an enormous human bowling ball without the finger holes. The coach ordered me down into a 3-point stance. I felt no escape, but was hesitant to place my hand on the ground. But what else can you do before such weighty authority and peer pressure? Out of the corner of my eye, I viewed a sinister leer on the face of the head coach. The linebacker leaned forward and gave a guttural snarl, reminding me of a lion's anticipatory, satisfied growl prior to ripping into his prey. I took a resigned breath, and after a few interminable seconds, the coach yelled, "Hut." What happened next was likely a testament to blind luck. I charged ahead, possessing a faster start than did the stocky, muscled-up one. It simply took him more time to accelerate that much mass. Before he could take more than a step or two, I struck him in the legs like a slender arrow striking the treads of a Sherman tank. I somehow managed to entangle my reed-like self between his stump-like churning legs. The stocky one's forward progress slowed. He tottered, lost his balance, pitched forward, and crashed to the turf. From the crowd of players and coaches rose a collective gasp of amazement. The scrawny sophomore had actually tackled the team's Goliath. Any affirmation, though, was lost on me, as all I felt was a terrific pain from a newly acquired non-anatomical positioning of my left thumb. My fledgling career on the varsity football team had been crushed as surely as had my left thumb. Well, that's how I got introduced, really, to our family physician, Dr. Bill Powell, who had a great influence on me, but he was also quite a perfectionist, and he set my the many fragments of bone in my thumb and casted it. And then he x-rayed it, and he wasn't quite pleased with how it came out, so he took the cast off. He rebroke it, recasted it. And he did this three or four times over the next 3 to 4 weeks. And fortunately, it was still summer, so I didn't have to attend school. But I was sitting there in his waiting room feeling very bored. And finally, Dr. Powell sticks his head out into the waiting room and says, "Tom, I bet you're getting bored and you've read all those magazines." "Yes, sir." "Would you like to follow me around and see some patients?" What a gift. What a gift. So that's what I did for the last couple of weeks, is follow Dr. Powell from room to room. I saw some absolutely amazing human beings with a variety of different medical problems. And they became very memorable, and three of which I talk about in this chapter, which is about the second chapter in the book, including one which was particularly memorable. You understand I was only 15 or 16 at the time. And this was, Dr. Powell was trying out something fairly new at the time. It was called cosmetic surgery. He was a general surgeon. And he had just started to do mammoplasties. And he took me in this room, and there was this very attractive, flashy, blonde hair, peroxide blonde lady who was sitting there in this rather loose-fitting blouse and these long bangles, and she had very strong perfume. And Dr. Powell was explaining that he had just performed mammoplasties on her, and he was really proud of his work, and what did I think of it? And at that point, this lady threw up her blouse and was so pleased by these new orbs that she had that were bruised and sutures running around them, and I wasn't sure if I was admiring his surgical work or oogling, but it was certainly one that a 16-year-old boy would never forget. But even more so than that, I saw the type of relationship that Bill Powell had with his patients. He dealt with everyone as an individual. They had great trust in him. He was able to ferret through their complaints, and sometimes there were a lot of extraneous information came out to get to the amount of information that was required to make a diagnosis and begin a treatment. And I thought, this is wonderful. This has got to be a lot more interesting than the law. I'm sorry if there are any lawyers in the office, in the audience. But I knew from then on that medicine was going to be my future vocation. I'm going to skip through a good part of the book, which was in Minnesota, to get to Texas, which I'm sure these Texans are much more interested in hearing about, and talk to you a little bit about a patient that I met shortly after I arrived in Lubbock, back in Lubbock. This was about 1981, and the weather was about like that the day I met this patient. And this is entitled "The Man Who Played Pinochle with Dogs." And I'll just read, the beginning chapter without giving you away the whole story. As I entered the room, the elderly man sitting on the exam table glared at me. I noticed he was of small stature with a face as fissured as a prune. "What's keeping you, Doc, out playing golf?" "What a day to play golf. Would have to nail my shoes to the tee box. Sorry to keep you, Mr. Woodley. I'm Dr. Hutton. What can I do for you today? The patient peered down his nose like a hawk, sizing up its prey. He wore a mauve sweatshirt that screamed in bold letters, "If things get better with age, then I'm approaching magnificence." From beneath the bill of a dirty, pulled-down Dallas Cowboys cap, he scrutinized me through slit-like eyes. I slowly lowered myself onto the wheel stool and tried to act nonchalant, as if I had ample time to wait out his petulance. "It's nice to finally see you," he intoned, not yet willing to give up his peak. "Was anxious to get home to Muleshoe before the sandstorm hit." While his words were barbed, his Western drawl and soft Parkinson speech reduced their sting. Outside, the wind began to wail, reaching just in the higher octaves. In unison, our eyes went to the ceiling as if making entreaties to an angry Mother Nature. "Mr. Woodley, I see you've seen Dr. Bianchin." I observed the corner of Sam Woodley's mouth turn up slightly. He nodded his head. He ran a gnarled old hand along the table, smoothing the hygienic paper. "Yep, for years Doc Bianchin's been my doctor. Without him, I'd be moving slower than a constipated slug." "Like that funny talking Yankee, mind you, even if the SOB rooted for the wrong team," pointing up to his Cowboys cap. I continued with my get-acquainted conversation, sensing a thaw in my frigid reception. "So watch sports, do you?" "Do now. Wife up and died 3 years ago. My kid took off for godless California. Not much else to do since leasing out the farm." After a few sympathetic clucks, I ask, "Live by yourself?" "Yep, but sonny, you see a young heifer wanting to play house with an old guy like me, you let me know." Mischievous grin came across his gnomish, weather-beaten face. I felt myself beginning to admire the pluck of this old cotton farmer. "I'll keep it in mind, Mr. Woodley. How are you spending your time these days?" "Frankly, not doing much. Try to take care of the place as best I can. Played cards with my Gladys before the cancer took her." Before he turned his head away, I noticed his eyes had begun to glisten. His defiance for them was melting faster than an ice cube on a Texas sidewalk in July. He then struck me as appearing vulnerable and painfully lonely. "What problems are you having with your Parkinson's disease?" In a muted voice, he described difficulty cutting his food and tying his shoelaces. His tremor and shuffling feet embarrassed him, but he surprised me by saying that he found it harder now to shuffle cards. "Shuffling cards," I thought. "Why does he need to shuffle cards? Solitaire?" I inquired about side effects of his medicine. "Upset stomach or vomiting?" "Nah, Doc. Cast iron stomach." Ask a further series of unproductive questions, then I ask a standard, almost throwaway type question. "Have you ever seen animals or people that were not really there?" He hesitated and noticed his jaw muscles tighten. I sat motionless on my mobile stool, anticipating his response. His face took on a quizzical look that could have not appeared more puzzled had I hopped off my stool, stood on my head, and begun to spit out marbles. Sam measured me, his bushy eyebrows knitted up like two angry caterpillars about to do battle. "Maybe, maybe not. Well, could you help me out a little bit more?" He ran the back of his hand across his square chin. I observed his lips quiver ever so slightly. I felt Sam Woodley held a secret he'd not planned to share that day with this new doctor. After taking an unusual interest in the ceiling tiles, Sam Woodley began, suddenly dropped his head and blurted out dryly, "Well, Doc, I see some dogs." The chapter goes on to describe three hallucinated dogs that came to his remote farmhouse. It's not these dogs, obviously. This is Cassius Marcellus Coolidge's pictures. But I wonder if this might have inspired his hallucination, because he had very precise descriptions of the three different dogs, and they would come, and he would set up his card table, and he would put out dog biscuits and put out water. And you could tell he really enjoyed being a host for these dogs when they came to visit him each day. And he was getting a lot of enjoyment from the pinochle. But he was having trouble shuffling the cards because the dogs certainly couldn't shuffle the dogs and play pinochle. I'm not going to spoil the story for you, those who want to read the rest of the book, but I think it does have a somewhat surprise ending, because this patient immediately taught me how important it is to have rapport with the patient. This is something he was embarrassed about. New doctor, Would I think he's crazy? That's usually what people are thinking about. And yet with Parkinson's disease, especially with more chronic Parkinson's treated, hallucinations are fairly common. And oftentimes they're very benign and not threatening, and we don't have to worry too much about them. But other times they can be very frightening, and people can be driven from their homes because of the fear of these fearful hallucinations. So I learned a lot from Mr. Woodley in terms of the importance of establishing rapport. And one thing you have to do as a neurologist is establish rapport. 80% of the diagnoses that we make are based on what people tell us. Maybe another 10% from our examination, and then perhaps some others from the different imaging tests and blood tests that we perform. So talking to the patients is all important. And plus, we deal with people who have chronic illnesses who are back for many, many years frequently. And so we have a good time to establish rapport and get to know them as friends and their family as well. And it's these family members for which I developed just boundless respect and what they went through to care for their loved one. And this was especially true for Alzheimer's disease because the burden of caregiving is so great with Alzheimer's disease. So I thought I might read from a chapter which was a collection of stories, but particularly about this one that I thought said something about a particular caregiver. And his name was Freddie, and he was taking care of his dad, and his dad had Alzheimer's disease. His dad was an old Scotsman, and his wife had died of cancer, and Freddie ended up having to take care of his dad, Mac. And he was not prepared for this. His mother, like so many caregivers, had really not shared how serious things were, particularly late at night when things got more confusing and he became agitated. And so he was in my office one day, and he was describing how he was struggling to take care of Mac. And he had come back from Arkansas in his farm with his dad. But he did say, "Doctor, I had one idea that worked out pretty good. Tell me, Freddie." Freddie gathered himself and began to tell his story. "Dad has always loved the American game of baseball. My Arkansas farm is too far removed to receive the St. Louis Cardinals radio broadcast. They're Mac's favorite team. So I obtained an audio tape of a particularly exciting ball game. Each night after dinner, I loaded into my tape recorder and turned it on for Dad. Every replaying of the game for Mac is a novel experience." What a great idea. His memory loss is actually a positive here for his enjoyment, I said. "I even know where he is in the game without being in the room. In the bottom of the sixth inning, the Cardinals hit a home run, causing Dad to let out a hearty war whoop and applaud loudly. You think William Wallace was alive and well in the hills of Arkansas. In the top of the eighth, the opposing team beats out an infield ground ball for a base hit. A bench-clearing rhubarb breaks out. The radio announcer describes the Cardinals' coach and first base umpire standing nose to nose, jawing animately at each other. Dad never fails to jump out of his chair and unleash a tirade of Scottish profanity. Even Buddy gets excited and begins to run around the room and bark." "Freddie, that's a clever idea," I said. Freddie beamed with his self-assurance having been restored. When the game is over, Mac and Buddy head off down the hallway. Dad goes to bed contented that his Cardinals have won another close game. Sometime later, I heard from Freddie, and it was in the form of a letter, and he had and his family had a great appreciation for the help that we've been able to give them at the Alzheimer's Institute at Texas Tech. But Freddie had his own medical problems, and he had been in an accident and had to have canes. But one day he got up, his dad's bed was empty. He couldn't find his dad. He had escaped from the house. He got his canes. He managed to wander down the hill because he saw something, a dark spot down at the end of the hill next to the pond. I just want to read a very brief bit of that letter. "In Mac's last years, he had another helper, a four-footed one named Buddy, who'd wandered onto the farm and adopted Mac. He became a target for Mac's always generous affection. Buddy was Mac's constant companion and never failed to lead Mac home from their walks. Now looking back, I've come to think of Buddy as an angel dog. I think the dog came to live with us for the purpose of looking after my old dad. I'm ever so grateful for this gift. I wouldn't say this caregiving stuff was ever easy. Wouldn't wish it even on an Englishman. But I can say that I've learned something about myself. I found I could do some pretty unpleasant things like parenting my own dad, changing his diapers, trimming his bushy mustache, looking out for him. I never imagined I could have done such things. Never thought I had it in me. I guess it's just like the old saying, life is a dance. If you're smart, you'll learn the steps. Skipping ahead then, Freddie went on to write, I'm reassured that Dad died peacefully and with his ever-faithful dog Buddy nearby. Oh, and I wanted to let you know that the night before Mac died, he heard the Cardinals win another close one. In a metaphor that I found strangely comforting and moving, Freddie concluded his letter by saying, I believe his companion Buddy must have been the one to call the final inning of Mac's last trip around the bases as my dad looked into the sky for the Cardinals' winning home run. Sincerely, Freddie Campbell. This represents so many caregivers for what they did, for the sacrifices that they made. I am just incredibly impressed by the stamina, and frequently these people went well beyond what they ever thought that they could do. And so it was really good if we could find some respite for these family members, and I really wanted to write a chapter as a tribute to them. Also, there was a chapter in here that is different from the rest, and I'll admit that, because all of these people I had some personal knowledge of, with the exception of one. And the chapter is about Adolf Hitler and his Parkinson's disease. And so I think Courtney was interested in this. She likes this chapter, as to John. So I wanted to share just a little bit about this because this was a topic that I became very interested in just prior to my retirement. And we actually gave a paper at an International Parkinson's Conference. And to my great surprise, it never happened to me before. The next day, it was across front pages of papers across North America and Europe that Adolf Hitler's Parkinson's disease may have helped the Allies win World War II, which was what we were speculating, but it was highly speculative. But I think it's been known for some time. We didn't discover that Adolf Hitler had Parkinson's disease. He had that, and I'll show you a videotape, which I think will convince you of that. But we're the first ones to talk about the duration of his Parkinson's disease and the great likelihood that this affected his cognitive memory status. And there's a well-known Parkinson's neuropsychological syndrome, which very much impacts the patient's ability to plan ahead and to change from one thought to the next. It's kind of an inflexibility that happens. We did find a lot of historical support for that in people interviewed after World War II who had worked closely with Adolf Hitler. And we saw many reports of this. So I just wanted to share a little bit of this from the chapter. The other thing which is well known now is Adolf Hitler had coronary artery disease. And at the time that he... There we go. I can't keep up with my slides. At the time that, say, Operation Barbarossa, which was 1941... when Adolf Hitler elected to move up the invasion of Russia, the Soviet Union, moved it up 3 years. Why did he do that? This was before he had the sound-activated torpedoes. He didn't have the V-1s, V-2s. They didn't come out till a couple of years later. He had not yet defeated England. There was just a whole lot of reasons why it was premature, and yet he had coronary artery disease that would have predicted he would be dead by 1943. He had Parkinson's disease that predicted he would be dead by 1943. So I think that there may have been some medical reasons why he moved up the time clock the way he did. So I'm just going to share one section of the chapter. Due to his perception of failing health and diminishing vigor, Hitler had strong incentives to hasten the timetable for Operation Barbarossa. That's the invasion of the Soviet Union. I speculate he recognized that his poor health limited the time he had to accomplish his conquests. By 1941, Hitler would already have lived the expected 8 years, the average survival rate in the 1940s for a person with Parkinson's disease. His decision to invade early, once made, would prove to be an appalling strategic mistake. A little bit of historical evidence to support this before I show you the video. From the summer of 1942 onward, it struck Albert Speer how rigid Hitler had become in his thinking. He described Hitler's mind as moving along an unalterable track. Speer described Hitler as clearly having lost his mental agility of his earlier days. He lacked the capacity for thinking through large-scale conceptualizations, instead focusing on more trivial matters that could have been delegated to his by then frustrated generals. Speer described Hitler at this stage of his life as showing a dull obstinacy. These observations use the typical cognitive impairment now known to exist with chronic Parkinson's disease, and I speculate likely contributed to his egregious tactical errors, including particularly at the Battle of Normandy. One of the historical questions has been, why did Adolf Hitler wait 3 days to release the three panzer units in the 15th Army Reserves? You may remember that the battle, particularly at Omaha Beach, was touch and go and could have very easily gone the other way. Certainly von Rundstedt, who was in charge of the Western Front, had asked immediately for releasing the troops. Adolf Hitler clung to the idea that the battle was going to be fought at the Pas-de-Calais and that he would not release the troops because he believed that was just a feint that the Allies were calling. Of course, looking out, thousands of ships on the horizon, that was some feint. But he was so sticky in his thinking that he was unable to change his mind that the battle was not going to become at the Pas-de-Calais. I believe this was the cognitive inflexibility of Parkinson's disease. This is a montage, and for years I wondered why Adolf Hitler always was holding on to something with his left hand. And this is a montage fairly typically. He's holding gloves frequently or a scroll of papers, or he's holding his left hand. This is a very typical trick for someone with Parkinson's disease with bad tremor, because tremor is embarrassing. But if you manipulate something in your hand or hold something, it will suppress the tremor. And so this is a trick known by everybody with tremor, Parkinson's disease. His signature, again, a piece of evidence of his Parkinson's. Back in the top one's 1923, that would have been his normal signature. But look what happens over the years, how it gets smaller, particularly how it tapers off from the first letter to the end. That's micrographia. Parkinson's disease is the only neurological disease that has micrographia. And toward the end, 1942, 1943, certainly 1945, his handwriting has become illegible. A very convincing bit of evidence, I think, for his Parkinson's disease. Let me show you a videotape now, if I may. Mark?
Here I am.
Before, Hitler was living with another symptom that has puzzled medical investigators. For at least 3 years, Hitler had suffered from tremors in his hands and legs. What could have been the cause? And was it a sign of a deterioration in his mental powers?
The video's not very good here, but can you see the flexion, resting tremor that he has?
Obvious. There was one diagnosis, however, that might account for these symptoms. Parkinson's disease. The chronic brain disorder that wastes body and mind.
A little stooped there.
For such a superman as Hitler, Parkinson.
You often notice in videotapes that Adolf Hitler carries something in his left hand. This is, in fact, a very common technique for a Parkinsonian to use in order to suppress the tremor. But
something
in addition
for
to
History
many
Channel.
Other symptoms that come on, perhaps the earliest being a lack of arms.
And the later, this shuffling of the feet.
Look at his feet.
That is, of course, in the eyes of his...
Very typical shuffling gait of Parkinson's disease. I think if you see these features, certainly a neurologist can diagnose this. But the Nazis were very good about suppressing this, and Adolf Hitler lost contact with the German people the last couple of years that he was in power, which he had been such a motivating force. This was a tremendous loss to the war effort for the Nazis. But they were able to edit out signs of his Parkinson's disease, but right at the end, the censorship broke down and some video was able to get out. So I do think that in this case, this was not a nice person who had Parkinson's disease data, but I do think that neurological disease may have contributed to the outcome of World War II and in a very favorable way for the Allies. Let me skip back then and talk about, some of you may know Susan Emke. She lived in Lubbock for many years. She was my nurse practitioner, wonderful friend. In the book, we call her Vicki Masters. Susan only asked two things. She read the book. She liked the book. But she asked two favors of me, Courtney. I should tell you, this part isn't true. She wanted to be thinner and prettier in the book. And she is. She's a cute little redhead in the book. But she is unsurpassed in real life in terms of her heart for patients, and she's a wonderful friend to this day. So I'm going to read something from, I think it's the last chapter, Sail Away, and Susan was responsible for this. The ship's horn boomed expectantly. The band played Happy Days Are Here Again. Champagne glasses clinked and peals of laughter crested and faded. Milling dockside relatives waved handkerchiefs. Then the ship's horn again blasted, increasing further our near-frenzied anticipation. Gray plumes began to billow from the huge smokestacks. It was just then that I felt it, a faint shuddering that pulsed the deck beneath my feet. Have the ship's engines really started, or have the tremors of our Parkinson's party suddenly synchronized? It would be a never-to-be-forgotten cruise, but mostly for all the wrong reasons. I served as a physician for a tottery band of intrepid travelers, a group that had stubbornly but bravely refused to cave in to their shared malady. It was February 2001. We were aboard the Gigantus, the pride of the Mauritanian line, come to think of it, the only ship of the line still afloat. With the ship docked at the port of Fort Lauderdale, the crew scrambled about in expectation of sailing. My planned and unannounced retirement was still 6 months away. Vicki, my fearless nurse practitioner, had once again connived me into serving as neurologist and educator for this indomitable group. As we stood on the top deck of the Gigantus, I reviewed our trembling charges. I felt shattered by a metaphysical dread resulting from a doubling in the number of Parkinson's disease patients compared to earlier cruises. News of the success of prior sailings has spread like a contagion among national Parkinson's disease support groups. I recall the prior cruises had been largely without incident, providing me a modicum of reassurance. Their physicians had certified our travelers healthy enough for a cruise, but as I was to learn, these medical screenings may have been more procedural than precise. Shuttling among our group, Vicki passed out flutes of bubbly champagne. In her role as self-appointed pharmacist, Vicki also provided a chaser of anti-nausea patches. I was surprised that Melanie, our clinic nurse, was among Vicki's grateful recipients of a patch. Melanie hurriedly slapped the anti-motion patch behind her right ear. I observed she already wore the telltale pallid, lemon-sucking facial expression of seasickness. And we've yet to depart the dock. Well, I should have known that was foreshadowing this cruise, and I will tell you that we lost a patient on this cruise. It was a lady who was on the deck that first day, and she, let's see if I have something. Oh, yes, there we go, Sail Away. And that she was in a wheelchair, and she was with an attendant, but I could see a feeding tube snaking out from under her blouse, and she had a urine bag on the wheelchair, and she had a tracheostomy. And she was very thin and looked very weak and didn't look like she should be going on a cruise. She came to the first educational session or two, and then we kind of lost track of Mary, and she didn't show up, but a lot of people didn't show up for the educational sessions. We didn't worry about it until I got called one night late to run to her cabin just after she'd taken her last breath. And what had happened is he had a suction machine there, and the attendant didn't tell anyone, but it was a European ship with an American plug, and they were incompatible, and she basically drowned and died. So there it was, by this time, 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning, and I was supposed to call Minneapolis, where she was from, and talk to her daughter and tell her that Mom had just died, having established no rapport. And I did this on this ship-to-shore phone that I remember was on the whoop, whoop, whoop type phones. And I finally gave the sad message. And there was this long pause. And I kind of braced for the onslaught. And she said, "Well, we thought she'd die." And the old forehead slap, I wanted to say, "Well, why did you send her on a cruise?" And she started talking. And it became obvious to me that Mary had wanted so badly to go. She had twisted her doctor's arm. Her daughter told us that the year before she'd written a burro down in the Grand Canyon. A couple years before she'd gone skydiving. She absolutely refused to give in to her malady that was Parkinson's disease. That so typified the people on this cruise. They refused to let the disease define them. They were human beings. They had a medical problem, but they first of all were human beings. And I thought that Mary personified that so well. There was another lady on the cruise that I also remember for the very same reason. And she was a Texan. And she, kind of a typical, loud, brassy Texan sort of gal. And she was proud of her tremor. And she really had bad tremor. And I kind of asked her, "Well, why are you so proud of your tremor?" She said, "Well, doctor, there are two things I can do better than anyone else on this ship. One of them, I can mix a better martini. And secondly, I'm really terrific at sexual foreplay." Well, okay. you can't argue with that. But this is a case of people taking ownership of their symptoms and not letting it take them away and keep them out of the public eye. And I just thought that was a great example of courage. And there were so many people on this cruise that showed such tremendous courage. And I did appreciate that. I'm going to answer just one final question, and I hope then that we can have an exchange of ideas. So I'd certainly welcome your thoughts, your comments, any questions you might have. But people have asked me why I named the book Carrying the Black Bag. And Joanna had something to do with this, I must admit. But the black bag plays a role in so many of these stories that are throughout the book. And it really is iconic, I think, of how neurologists work. We have to carry our tools and bags. We still examine people. We still touch patients. We still talk to patients. We're kind of old-fashioned in that respect. And we therefore end up learning from our patients. Well, I'm going to read this last section. "The quaint custom of carrying a medical black bag has fallen from favor since my graduation from medical school. Perhaps black bags were thought unnecessary in the era of modern imaging and laboratory-intensive medicine due to the unfortunate de-emphasis of medical history-taking and physical exam skills. But for the practice of neurology, the black bag continues to serve an important function. The neurological examination still requires a careful history-taking and the use of instruments to perform the examination. Neurology provides a bridge between the more anachronistic but personalized focus on history-taking, examination, and long-term doctor-patient relationship, and the modern imaging and laboratory-intensive practice of medicine." How many people have been to your doctor lately and he never touched you and he looked at his computer most of the time as he or she typed it in? Yeah, it's kind of a common experience. I understand why that is. It's just that I think that's a loss, and I'm concerned about that, and we have to figure out some way to maintain that very personal contact, in my opinion. "Admittedly, the medical black bag also became something of a signature for me. Many times I heard nurses or families exclaim, 'We always know when you're on the floor or in the clinic or wherever, when we see a black bag.' To my knowledge, when I took down my medical shingle, my black bag was the last one in use in Lubbock. When I retired from medicine, my black bag traveled with me to the ranch. There I placed my original ebony companion on my study shelf, where today it peeks over my shoulder and resurrects fond memories. It is only fitting my black bag makes its appearance in many of these stories, as it represents to me much of what is good and eternal about the field of medicine. At some point, most of us will face personal health challenges. I hope these medical vignettes will prompt more reasoned and comfortable consideration of how to face such challenges, will assist in maintaining personal dignity despite the inconvenience or even the threat of terminal illness. Let us be inspired by the grace, courage, and poise shown by many of those depicted within this volume. If this salutary effect occurs, then my effort in writing this book will not have been in vain. I thank you. Be glad to take any questions. Thank you. Yes, Emma.
Thank you. Tom, when you were preparing for writing and trying to form all your thoughts on this, with all of the variety of patients over the years that you had, was it an emotional ride for you to relive this and trying to figure out if you could be fair and without showing too much emotion when you were doing the manuscript?
Thank you, Emma. That's a good question. And when you dredge up remembrances from so many years, you kind of relive some of the anxiety that went with it. I hope there's a character arc of the author in the book, starting off from a pretty anxious young doctor to one who became more mature and hopefully more skilled in his practice of medicine. But there also was another aspect to this, and I think it's somewhat therapeutic to go back. And I began my talk by saying that these stories had to come out. And I really didn't have time during my busy practice of medicine to write these down, although I started keeping consults and histories and different things that I put in a file for later use, and I drew on heavily in writing this book. So I found that this was a catharsis in a way. It was therapeutic. At the same time, it was somewhat anxiety-provoking to relive some of these emotionally charged events. Good question. Thank you, Emma. Emma, by the way, until very recently, was in charge of the Osher Lifelong Learning Institute at Texas Tech. And she called me up one day. And there's some debate about how she got my name down in the Hill Country. And she asked if I would help her to start a chapter of Ollie in the Hill Country, which we've been working on for the last 2 years, and it's been a wonderful experience. It's a great program. I hope that most of you aren't old enough yet to attend Ollie, but when you're 50, it's a great program, community ed program offered by Texas Tech. Other questions?
I have a question for you. As a caregiver for my mother, whose health is declining with dementia, I found that a sense of humor is valuable. And listening to the laughter in the group and hearing your stories, I sense that's true of a lot of people who are dealing with their own illnesses or the illnesses of a loved one. Could you speak about keeping a sense of humor?
Oh, I think that's so important. It's a very good point. And I think in the book you'll see that I really tried to mix in humor without any way demeaning the patients, because I think that the patients and their families need a sense of humor. Much better to laugh at some of the mistakes that mom or dad makes, and because you're not going to talk him out of the mistake, and it's better just to chuckle about it a little bit. And even among the healthcare professionals, we had to try to keep a sense of humor. Neurology has a lot of very serious illnesses and a lot of bad outcomes, unfortunately. And we would try to look for some of the humor, and patients so often would be self-deprecating in their humor. And I think that was a very healthy sign if a patient was able to do that. Yes, I hope the humor in the book, you find that a lot of people who've read it are surprised by the amount of humor that appears in a book about neurological patients largely. Thank you. Thank you. Any other? Oh, yes, yes.
My daughter's father-in-law was just recently, well, I guess about 2 years ago, diagnosed with Parkinson's, and he was a physician here in Lubbock who was forced to retirement last year. And I guess in helping her and her husband deal with this, what can the community of family do to support a family going through Parkinson's?
be available to them. The hardest thing is for the closest caregiver to give up control, but it is so important, and we're always stressing, and depending on how bad it is, now this person may or may not be that bad at this point, but you've got to take care of yourself as a caregiver. That's number one, and having someone else who can step in and help, particularly with Alzheimer's care, it's so important. I think getting involved in one of the support groups and finding out that you're not the only one dealing with this, and you can begin to share examples of what you've dealt with, and other people will come in, well, this is what we did about that. Or maybe becoming really part of the Parkinson's community. I don't know if they're doing cruises anymore, but they certainly have a lot of meetings and activities, and I believe there's still support groups available throughout Lubbock for the families and for the patients, exactly. So those are the first things. And then learn as much as you can. Things are moving very quickly with regard to Parkinson's disease. I think there are like 5 new medicines coming out in the next couple of years for Parkinson's disease. That's exciting. It used to be Parkinson's disease was a killer, like Adolf Hitler. These days, someone with Parkinson's disease will live as long as someone without Parkinson's disease of the same age. It's not the killer. It certainly can affect the quality of life, but not the quantity of life so much. So learning about these new medicines, learning how to better cope with it, there are things that can be done to assist beyond just the medicine. There's surgeries, there's a variety of physical therapy, occupational therapy, speech therapies that can benefit individual symptoms and signs of Parkinson's disease.
Thank you.
Sure. Thank you.
Any more?
Trudy, do you want to speak to that? I should tip my hat to Trudy. She's been wonderful throughout this whole process. More than once, while I was totally immersed in writing this book, I completely forgot that Trudy was waiting for me downtown Fredericksburg for dinner or at a meeting. And my phone would go off and, oh, yes, I'm sorry, I totally forgot Trudy. But she went through all that with very good humor, and I do appreciate it. And the second thing I want to say about Trudy is it's standard practice an author should never ask their spouse to edit what they write. Because, frankly, the first 6 drafts are terrible. I hate my first 6 drafts. And Trudy ended up getting about draft 2. You know, you want the... And Trudy would give thoughts about the draft, and I would eventually write it and rewrite it, and finally to the point where I was courageous enough to have Joanna read it. So I appreciate that, Trudy. I shouldn't have done it, but she was the best in-house editor I possibly could have had. Joanna's the best editor at a press I think I could have ever had. Yes, Dr.
Have you ever thought about writing a book for children that might help them with a grandparent or that has?
Well, you know, the book's already been written. Trudy wrote it. She wrote it. It's published by the American Parkinson's Association. Mark Parkinson's, the APDA. And it's still in their repertoire, I'm sure.
Is that where you would go to buy it?
It's free.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, you can get it free. It's a short book, and I think it's published in English and French, which, and Spanish. I'm really jealous. This is just in English. Thank you, Dr. Gerlach. Yes. And Trudy didn't even plant that, did she? Well, good. Well, if there are no more questions, we are going to do a book signing. If you want to purchase a book, we have some available, and there's some wonderful, delicious-looking food over there. So I hope everyone stays, and we can continue the conversation. Thank you so much. This has been wonderful for me. It's been a few years since I've been in the library. I'm not going to tell you how many. But Trudy and I were back in the stacks, supposedly studying, before we would go get coffee or whatever. Thank you so much. Wonderful. Oh, it's in their library. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. It's in your library. Thank you.